It looks like we have a good turnout here for our first presentation with the DAYL. This is for judicial interns who are serving on a lot of different courts, including mine, and quite a few of mine are here today. My name is Martin Hoffman. I'm the judge of the 68th District Court. You've probably seen me in other seminars if you've gone to the orientation or anything else. I'm so excited and honored to introduce Lisa Blue. She really needs no introduction, but I'll give you a short one. She is former president of the American Association for Justice, which is a national organization that fights for the rights of the jury trial. She's a PhD psychologist, has been for over 40 years, believe it or not. She's written a number of books on jury selection and is kind of known as throughout Texas as one of the premier experts on jury selection. She's been an attorney for also over 40 years. I asked Lisa to give me a bunch of really impressive things to tell you guys about her, and this is what she wanted me to tell you, but I can tell you just I've been very fortunate to see Lisa in trial and in jury selection, and she is without doubt one of the best lawyers in Dallas, if not in the state of Texas and in the country. And so we're all incredibly honored to hear from you, Lisa. She's going to be talking to us about staying sane during the era of the coronavirus. Now, if you have any questions, a lot of you guys have been on these before, please ask them in the Q&A function that's down on the bottom of your screen. I'll be fielding those questions and asking Lisa questions throughout the course of this. We kind of have a hard stop for this at 1 o'clock, so I will turn it over to Lisa now. Lisa, it's up to you.
Thank you, Judge. What a nice introduction. So I'm Lisa Blue. I'm a psychologist that loves lawyers and judges. And what I really want you to know about me is that I'm dyslexic and I've had anxiety. My husband passed away from cancer a while back and had depression because of that. And I'm telling you that because that's important for you to understand why I am so into one of these techniques that I'm going to talk about, and that is mindfulness. So with that, let's get started. Let's talk about techniques that I have as a psychologist to try to help lawyers stay sane. So what are we going to do in today's time? Well, the first thing I'm going to do is ask you some really hard questions. And those questions are, in the last 3 months, it's sort of the anniversary of 3 months of COVID that we've been shut in. Have you really worked on your relationships to better communicate with those that you love? Another hard question is, since lockdown, have you really improved yourself? Have you created new habits that will make you a better person? And have you worked on just your personal skills to be a better human? Those are the hard questions I have. Okay, so what are we doing today? Thinking about answers to those hard questions, it's never too late. I'm going to be talking a lot about my favorite technique, mindfulness, because if you're having a hard time, and here's what I believe as a psychologist about all of you on this call, you don't know. You don't know asking a friend, an intern, a boyfriend, a spouse, a parent, how are you doing? Oh, I'm fine. But you really don't know the true effect of being locked in for 3 months and law students, all that you've had to deal with and the stress. So, mindfulness, other than big pharma or doing nothing, I think it's mindfulness. The third thing we're going to do is we're going to run through some of my favorite life tips. So let me start with something good. This too shall pass. And when I say that, just knowing in your brain that this will not last forever, that it will go back to normal, should make us all feel good. So one of the things we're going to learn today is my favorite technique, mindfulness. And I'll say this from the bottom of my heart, you will never be a great lawyer or a great judge or a great human unless you know and understand and practice mindfulness. Mindfulness will change your life. Mindfulness, this tool in your toolbox, will help you and has helped me for years prevent depression, help you with anxiety and stress. So let's get started. So how are you feeling for the last 3 months, especially law students not knowing what to expect in the future? Are you feeling scatterbrained? Well, psychologists, experts say that's normal. All very normal in today's time. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to reset your brain. We're going to retrain your brain because this technique really works. I always tell people, and this is about my 14th lecture on mindfulness in the last 3 months, because people need it. It's the easiest thing I've ever had to teach and the hardest thing you will have to do, because your brain is on default. It hasn't been trained. But you can train your brain to stop worrying. I like to stick these life tips in. And this is why it's so important to make a good impression, a first impression, because you never get that second chance. And that's important whether it's a job interview or an opening statement or my first 30 seconds in jury selection. So I'm going to be sprinkling those life tips. So how do we flatten this curve on negative emotions? You know, this is pre-corona virus. It's me and my kids in better times. I have 3 kids. I'm a widow with 3 kids under 13. I have twins like Judge Hoffman. And then the virus hit, and here I am with gray roots, chip polish, and a huge bottle of wine. But at least it's called Vordaer. So things have changed around my house. I'd love to tell you, boy, I'm just spending all that great time with my kids. My kids never get off their devices. So I'll ask you, have you felt like a robot? Have you felt like Groundhog Day? Same thing, it all melts together. Well, wait a minute, am I a robot? Are you feeling overwhelmed, frustrated, anxious? Because remember, we're lawyers. We're law students. We're in the legal field. We are left brain creatures. There is no training in law school about how to deal with emotions or listening or psychological items such as that. So let's talk about this magic tool called meditation. It's mindfulness meditation. I'll tell you why it's blended together. But just something else about me, as a PhD psychologist, I am a science girl. I am not kumbaya, I'm not religious, I'm not spiritual. If I were a judge, I'd probably be pretty big on Daubert. I am science. And so I spend my time looking at the research to make sure that what I'm selling is real. So the benefits of this mind training, this meditation, to increase your focus, your memory, increase creativity, increase self-compassion, reduce depression and anxiety, all good things that will make you a better person, therefore a better lawyer. Hopefully, if you have a practice, you'll go even deeper, even more thoughtful about it. So let's start. Is your mind full, or is it mind full of thoughts, garbage, repetitive thoughts that you just can't stop thinking about? Because I know, as a psychologist, someone who adores this topic and believes in it, we have monkey mind. Our mind has thoughts, they swing from branch to branch like a monkey. And as a trial lawyer, being aware that juries and humans have 50 to 70,000 thoughts a day. That's how active our minds are, and that's why training is so important. So what is this tool called mindfulness? And you'll see I have it says 40 seconds on the side. That's how long the videos are.
Mindfulness for me is just a technique of identifying what's there and distinguishing between the neuroses and the virtues or the good qualities.
The most common definition is paying attention to present moment experience.
Mindfulness is your natural state of being.
It's the awakening of possibility and the possibility of awakening.
But also it's about just noticing what is happening every moment of the day.
Mindfulness is one thing. It's paying attention
to the actions that you are taking.
It's a sustained quality of being present.
So why is it so important when you're in law school class and you realize you've been daydreaming, you are, have not been focusing? So mindfulness is so simple. It just means paying attention in a particular way without judging it, without saying, oh, I'm not doing it right. Just be totally in the present moment, right here, right now. Train your brain.
So mindfulness is paying attention to the moment with an open and a willingness to let go of old patterns and live in the present.
Because when you live in the present and you're focused, you're gonna hear this again, you may not have known it as well as you thought or paid as much attention. So who are we today? It's even worse because of the virus. We are addicted to our screens. This is research that's been done. I mean, 75% of us take our phones to bed, 62% at the table, 80% exercise. Yes, we have an addiction. And so what does Dr. Einstein say about this? He said he fears when technology overlaps with our humanity, then we'll just be a generation of idiots. And I thought about what he meant by that, but think about it. I can look something up on Google. I don't have to use a book anymore. I can get everything I know without looking at a book. I just look at this little tiny contraption. This is what we've become. Isn't this sad? We're so addicted, all of us, to our phones. And it's a way really to deal with loneliness. So mindfulness.
Did you get it?
This is my listeners.
Hello. Did you get it? Were you even watching?
Watching what?
The experts explaining mindfulness.
Oh, yeah. I was watching.
What did it say?
Well, I don't know, something about mindfulness.
So what does that mean?
I don't have a clue.
Because you weren't paying attention.
Because all of us, we are on default. So let's take an example. Oops. Yeah, fellow Dallasites. Do you remember this case? This police officer murdered a man because she thought she was in her apartment. And what if she had been practicing mindfulness? Look at the differences in her apartment and the man that she accidentally shot. Mindfulness. But how sad. Even our highest health officials. This is when our president is talking about don't touch your face. You've got to be vigilant about your health. And here he is, Dr. Fauci, touching his entire face. There's another health official talking about keep your fingers out of your mouth. And the next thing she did was take her finger in her mouth and turn the page. Not mindful. Mindfulness is not present. How do we do it? How do we train our brain? And I'll tell you, as a psychologist, here's my belief. You can't hear the good stuff enough. So maybe some of you know about mindfulness, but just focus, because you will learn new things. So it's like training a puppy. If you go out and you get a new puppy, sorry, I'm in Park City and somebody who has a dog. So let's say you want to train your brain, and it's like bringing a little puppy home. And when they go to the bathroom, you put them and they go away, they go off the paper. Then you bring them back onto the paper. You don't beat them You don't beat the puppy. You just, like your brain, you bring it back to the present moment. Okay.
Mindfulness, as I study it, it's a very simple process of noticing new things.
As you notice new things, several things happen. The first is that you come to see that you didn't know it as well as you thought you did.
It's like pulling back the curtain on The Wizard of Oz, and we see what's really there.
And this act of noticing is the essence of engagement.
It just opens you up to becoming aware of things that were there before, but were not in awareness.
So if you're in class and the teacher's talking about impersonum jurisdiction, if you listen as if you've never heard of it before, even if you just wrote a paper about it, you will bring your brain back to learn new things that you thought you knew but you didn't. Here's one way. A couple of years ago, or quite some time ago, I was told I had high blood pressure, I'd have to be put on meds. And then using mindfulness, training my brain just to focus on what was happening in the present moment, you can see I got my reading significantly lower for my pulse and my blood pressure. That was without any type of medication. So how does it work in the brain? Everybody has stress. And the way it works, for a psychologist, we have a saying, amygdala on fire. That's when we hear about school shootings, church shootings, some horrible incident, we know that that person's amygdala is on fire. They can't control it. But when you practice mindfulness, what you're doing is you're calming down your prefrontal cortex. You're calming it down so that you have a conscious response. So you can even see in this imaging, the person that had a mindfulness practice, that there were holes. There were lack of holes in their brain, but the autopsy showed that the stress brain, actually seen in the frontal cortex, you have these holes created by stress. Well, here's another life tip. Nobody cares how much you know until they know how much you care. So having practiced law for 40 years, it's not what a jury thinks, oh, she knows a lot, which I don't. It's the feeling that the jury gets that you really care about what's going on. Okay, stress. Wow, we've all had it. The virus has caused us to have tremendous stress. We're not communicating, even though we're social animals. I had a friend say, you know, Lisa, trial work, it's a contact sport. You've got to be out there with people. It can lead to poor eating habits, insomnia, which I use mindfulness to combat my insomnia. It helps deal with depression.
All certainty creates an illusion of stability. So, certainty promotes mindlessness.
Mindlessness usually comes about by default. And it's not motivated, it just never occurred to you that this thing could be other things.
Mindless mode is, I think, the mode that we're on 90% of the time.
Most of the time, we eat and read the cornflakes box, or we eat and talk, or eat and dream, or most of us eat and read, or eat and watch TV.
You get in the car, you start the car, pull it out of the driveway, you drive somewhere for 10 or 15 minutes, you arrive, and you can't remember how you got there.
You can take a cigarette out of the pack, put it in your mouth, take out the lighter, light it, and be completely unaware, and you're going, and you don't remember any of that.
Because you were daydreaming the entire time.
And even when we're not in that mode, because we're thinking about something, we're mindless about almost everything else we're doing.
So your brain is on default to be mindless. And that's why we miss exits. That's why sometimes I try to put on two pair of glasses, because I'm daydreaming. And that's not really good for you. Unless you're trying to daydream, if you're laying out in a field and you're just letting your mind wander, that's perfectly fine, as long as you're aware that you're doing it. Stress is the enemy. We know that. It's a number one killer. It causes high blood pressure, sex problems, fatigue, insomnia, anxiety, migraines, on and on. There's nothing good that can happen with massive amounts of stress. This is what it feels like, especially in the law profession, where sadly, you know, when you're a trial lawyer, somebody wins and somebody loses, and that is stressful. And we know because it can actually be measured. We measure stress hormones and see what it does to our body, our breathing, our heart rate, our blood flow, how it affects us. Okay, take a little breather about another life tip. I'm wondering, I wish I could see you in person because I would ask you, what do you think the most important word in your vocabulary? It's not following your passion like they said Steve Jobs' speech was. At the end of your life, the most important word in your vocabulary is contribution. Do you feel like you made a contribution? And if the answer is yes, you've had a good life. Okay, back to what happens when you don't have this practice. You're in the midst of the coronavirus. Yes, you will feel depression, but let's see how mindfulness works to cure that.
Stress makes all kinds of physical ailments worse. Because a lot of what is distressing about physical illness, whether you're talking about pain or whether you're talking about any kind of debilitating state, fatigue, what makes it worse is how we process it centrally in our brain.
So I feel myself getting anxious. One of those unconscious systems has been triggered. So you now say, okay, I can't stop it. So what can I do? I can breathe. Take in air. That trick kicks on the parasympathetic nervous system, which counteracts the sympathetic fight flight system and kind of slows everything down a little bit.
And so when we change the system, that's here, the stress cycle between our thoughts that come up. So our thoughts, an event happens and we immediately perceive something as scary, or we need to do something about that. Something is urgent or it's important. Our brain creates a snap judgment of it being good, bad, right, wrong, fair, or unfair, and goes into a reactive mode.
As the great stress researcher Hans Selye put it, it's not stress that kills us, it's our reaction to stress.
And it's our reaction to stress that mindfulness helps you deal with. So, this is one of my favorite sayings because it's science. If I were to say, oh, I miss my husband, I remember when, I'm living in the past, I will be depressed. If I say as a law student, oh, I wonder, am I going back to school? Where am I gonna work? What's gonna happen to lawyers in the future? That's living in the future. That will make you anxious. But if you can train your brain to be totally right here, so you're focused, not on daydreaming, but focused on what you see on the screen, my voice, my picture, whatever, you are brain training. Because a mind in its own place and in itself can make a heaven of hell and a hell of heaven. So, let's change topics. No, I know you don't need to look at famous people, but I run through this because I don't care that they're famous. These are people that have a very, very serious mindfulness meditation practice. So just look at their facial expressions. And yes, they have money, but still it's that look of peace. It's that look of not looking stressed or worn out. It's the ability to literally train their brains so that they have a much better attitude in life, because this practice will make you happier, because you are more in control of your brain. Do you know that mindfulness, according to science, increases your ability to be creative? Nobody knows that better than this gentleman. Steve Jobs was a very, very serious meditator. I don't know anybody who's more creative. Now, the athletes have gotten into the act. Tiger Woods is a very serious meditator. He spends time in the morning just focusing on clearing his brain, focusing on his breathing. So here's another life tip for the law students, the interns. Choose your law partner more carefully than you would your spouse. You'll be spending more time with them. And really, that's because people like themselves. So when you eventually go to look for a job, ask yourself, train your brain, are these people that are like-minded? Do they have the same work ethic? Do I enjoy them? That's an interesting and important way to live your life. Now, of all the video clips, this is my favorite. Please focus and listen to it. It's 17 seconds, but these doctors have a very important message.
Can you give yourself 3 minutes? If you care enough about yourself to give yourself 3 minutes, maybe a minute in the morning, minute in the afternoon, minute in the evening, just sit and be present with your breath.
If we believe we can do it, we're going to be more motivated to actually do it. If we don't believe we can do something, we're not going to actually do it.
Those are two PhD psychologists, and their message is so important. Do you care enough about yourself just to take a minute to train your brain? Just to focus on your breathing? And yes, you will have thoughts. You just let those thoughts be like clouds and evaporate. But if you think you can do it, yes, you can. So yes, it's become a national phenomenon, especially in today's time when we are still on lockdown. Yes, it's starting to open up, but it's still, you're not gonna have now the same kind of human contact that you did before. Here's another life tip, and this one always makes me smile. Don't do anything that's gonna ruin your life. I remember I went to a parenting class, because I'm 68 this year with 3 kids under 13. And the presenter said, hey, do you remember? Yes, I do. When I was growing up, we had these little cameras where you had to go get the film and you had to take it in to be developed. Now, these kids, if they want to send a picture of their naked bodies, they just flip the phone around, snap it, and off it goes. So there's no speed bumps there. So if you're upset or angry, take one of those speed bumps, breathe, meditate, and take some time before you do anything stupid, which I hope you won't. Here are my recommendations for apps. I subscribe to almost all of them. I like 10% Happier because it has famous people that spend 2 minutes talking about the actual how-to, and then they meditate. I personally use Calm. I love Insight Timer because you can download these gorgeous bells for free. And I meditate for 10 minutes in the morning. And so I use their bells to tell me when to start and finish. I like Emily Fletcher. She went to Google and presented on why meditation is the new caffeine. So people will ask me, well, what if I just do it for an hour once a month? No, it's not the length, it's the frequency. I'd rather you do it 1 minute in the morning, afternoon, at night, every day, than for a longer period, once or twice a week. So you meditate, not so somebody will say, oh, you're a good meditator. It's to get good at life. That's why we meditate. This is one of my favorites. I grew up in Atlanta with being dyslexic and having serious learning disabilities. I see the word trail and it looks like trial to me. Meditation looks like mediation. I don't see a difference. But we know that if you practice, you can actually increase your IQ by 23%. And I know being my age, when the science shows me that 50-year-olds can have brains like 25-year-olds. That's something I'm interested in, just 15 minutes a day. The problem with meditation is this. You say to me, I want to do something about my arms or my stomach, and you exercise in the gym, and I can see the changes in your body. But when you do these exercises for your mind, you really can't see them like you can physical exercise. We're now looking at research to stave off dementia. For those of you with older parents, grandparents, it's a terrible disease you don't want. It can train your brain to focus, think faster. This is one of my favorites, is being happier. Wouldn't you all like to be in a good mood every day that you wake up? Well, it sure helps. Here's another life tip. When something bothers you, makes you aggravated, upsets you, think about this rule. If it's not going to matter in 5 years, don't spend more than 5 minutes on it. Mindfulness meditation will train your brain for better memory. It will teach you how to stay focused during class. And for all of you that have to take the bar exam, if you have mindfulness training, and I know this because I was a psychologist before I was a lawyer, and I used to hypnotize in law school those people that had test anxiety. And they would write me a check for $25. And when they did their brain training, when they meditated and learned how to get over their test anxiety, I'd tear up their check. So it does help you immensely with focus. So if you want to stay healthy, just meditate. Okay, now you're about to see 59 seconds. I love this movie for one point. How important mindfulness, the ability to focus, was for this young man.
Does it feel different to be up there without a rope?
It's obviously like much higher consequence.
I've thought about LCAP like for years, and every year I'm like, that's really scary. I'll never be content unless I at least put in the effort. LCAP is the most impressive wall on Earth. It's 3,200 feet of sheer granite. It's the center of the rock climbing universe.
Obviously, I get interview questions about it all the time. Oh, would you like to do that? You're like, yes, for sure.
If you're pushing the edge, eventually you find the edge.
Climbing LCAP without a rope, every move is mindful, because if not, he can fall to his death. So, now, mandatory. And this was from a speech I gave right when lockdown occurred. And I felt like the amount of depression was much higher back then, just because of fear of the unknown. But here, as a psychologist, somebody who I love to read on communication, productivity, happiness, all the psychological elements, especially for lawyers, because yes, we are left brain. But here's what I think: if you want to be happy, if you want to deal with the virus in the best way, write down the night before what you want to accomplish the next day, with the hardest at the top. If you get out of the way what you need to accomplish, and then you're going to feel so much better. Have a routine that's consistent. Another thing, again, brain training, make a list of what you have control over and what you don't. Be sure to exercise. That vitamin D is huge at a period when we're not supposed to be close, we're social distancing. Eat right and practice gratitude. Just writing down three things in the morning, or saying them, three things that you're grateful for, is going to make a difference in your ability to be happy. These are recommended. The others was mandatory if you wanted to deal with the virus in a way that made you survive better. Connect with three people a day. I told lawyers, hey, call three clients and just say, hey, I'm just checking on you. But connecting with people is so important. Journaling. I hate to write because of my learning disabilities, but if I carry around a notebook and anything I can think of, I just write it down, make lists. List makers, are that's good for your brain. And that's because when you have something that's going around and around in your brain, once you put it down on paper, it's you're training your brain to let go of it because now it's someplace else. Work on something to improve yourself. I promise you at the end of your life, people will ask you, or sooner than that, what did you do during the coronavirus? What was that like for you? And it won't be your answer that I'm so glad I worked more. What I hope that you will say is I really worked on my relationships. And that is so hard for all of us. I have a terrible struggle with parenting because I had my first child at the age of 55 years old. And now I have three, and it's a different world. Okay. Improve yourself. Learn one new thing a day. Learn something about your apartment or a computer skill. Next, in the beginning, I was so good. Walk in your closet. Spend 30 seconds and just throw out three things a day. Amazing how much you'll get done. Read, listen, and watch something that makes you laugh. Okay. So keep calm and carry on in mindfulness, practice, practice, practice. When I talk about practicing mindfulness, here's how easy it is. It's just sitting comfortably. Relaxing your body. You don't want to be tight when you're practicing. And just focus on your breath. Yes, you will have thoughts. Everybody does. You just let them evaporate and go back to clearing your brain just by focusing on your breathing. You are brain training by doing that. Okay. So here's more. I'm going to run through this because I'm going to give y'all my PowerPoint. I listen to books on tape. I rarely read because it's too frustrating, or I can, but it's frustrating. So I have listened to all of these books on tape. Exercising is very important to me. It helps me deal with depression. And so for 2 hours in the morning, it's always books on tape. And here are my favorite ones. And you can see I'm going to just fly through these. One or two might be like splitting the difference is good for negotiation. But all of these are about making you a better human being. Now, for you law students, one of my favorites, I have two favorites on this list for you. Rejection Proof, because maybe that's just because I'm from the South. Well, you know, dealing with rejection, how resilient are you, is so important being a law student. James Clear, I love. Brené Brown is wonderful for shame and how to get self-esteem. So you will have all of these. And not only are these books on how to be a better person. And again, my rule for putting these books on a list, are they the kind of books that when you're in your car and you've arrived to work, you think, ooh, I don't want to get out of the car because these books are so good. My other favorite for you during the time of the virus is Tiny Habits. This is by a psychologist who it's a good recommended strategy that you pair habits that you want to change with something that you already do. Let's say you don't floss your teeth. You need to do that more. If you set your floss right next to your toothbrush and you make it a habit that's changed onto another one.
Lisa, I apologize for interrupting you. One of the folks watching wanted to know what the second name of the second book you recommended was. Do you remember?
I do. It's called Rejection Proof. Rejection. And y'all, I'm going to give this to Sherry Harris, the whole PowerPoint. And please take all the list of books. And I have read these for you in advance. So they're all really good.
And then someone wanted to know the name of the Bells app that you mentioned earlier.
That's called Insight Timer. And just go, yeah, Insight Timer, download it. It's free. And just go to the timer, and they've got all these different bells, and you can use it when you meditate.
Do you, maybe you get to this later, do you have any recommendations for podcasts?
I do. It's on here.
Okay, sorry. Go ahead.
And here are documentaries that I picked, the ones I thought trial lawyers would love. And again, it's because they tell a great story. My favorite one in Dirty Money was about Donald Trump. And not everybody knows the story, but it's because of the way the story was told. Now this one, Trial by Media, I just watched last night. So I wanted to include it. It's old trials that I would remember. But it's so interesting about how the media is influenced. Okay, my favorite apps. I have insomnia. I download Sleepwatch. All these are free. It tells me how many hours I've slept. Pizzizz, and I use that to help me fall asleep because I read, I don't know if it's true, the Queen of England and J.K. Rowling use it to help fall asleep. Anything by James Clear. Here's some more audiobooks. I love stories, don't we all? Our brains love stories. And again, I love these on books on tape. This is a podcast that I really enjoyed. Now, listen, season two, don't get confused, because it has everything to do with Batson and a terrible prosecutor, right? Every good story needs a villain. Okay. Barking Up the Wrong Tree, Eric Barker. And I think this is probably my last in my candy store of books, documentaries, podcasts. I love this on persuasion. It's 23 minutes, a little bit long. But it talks about how Mr. Rogers taught us trial lawyers so much about how to be persuasive. Okay. Quickly, I'm going to get you out of here before one. Life tips. Just show up. Show up for everything, because it's FOMO. You don't want to miss out. But I've seen people, lawyers, that I would say are not bright, but they show up for everything and they're successful. Me, I'm certainly not the smartest person in the room, but I love to be around smart people. Next life tip, work backwards. I always tell trial lawyers, start with the jury trial. You have to know what you have to prove. A eulogy, you know, I in my head at 68 years old this year, I think about what do I want people to say at my funeral? And that's the way I live my life. Okay, backwards. Everybody needs a mentor. I know Judge Hoffman remembers Merrill Hartman, who love lawyers. I mean, this guy just never stopped talking about how much he loved lawyers. Don Williams, a philanthropist, my husband, Fred Barron, my love interest, Larry. Here's another life tip. Looking at really well-known trial lawyers, they speak to everybody the same. You speak to a judge and the garbage man the same with respect. Never miss an opportunity. This has special meaning for me, because the older I get, the more I'm willing to let go of feelings of jealousy. I used to feel so jealous when somebody got a big verdict. But never miss an opportunity means when somebody else has succeeded, you reach out and say, God, great work. Or I'm sorry about your loss, or happy birthday. Don't miss an opportunity to connect with somebody. Okay, I'm about, I'm so gonna make it on time. Hey, Judge, you saw this. Can I play it again? Because it's so cute. You think people have already seen it?
I don't know. You should play it.
Okay, it's 2 minutes and 40 seconds. So with that.
I'm majoring in pre-law myself.
Oh, no. Bad idea, trust me. Being a lawyer is the worst. Now stand back and let me tell you my tale of woe.
Between
didn't know what I wanted to do. So I took the LSAT and then just like that, got accepted at Glendale U. Everyone said it was a real safe bet, a prestigious and lucrative vocation. So I set out on a journey to become an attorney without a moment's hesitation. But here's some free advice I'm giving. Comes to deciding what to do for a living. Don't be a lawyer. Don't do it. Quickest way to ruin your life. Don't be a lawyer. Not worth it. It'll leave you dead inside. The job is inherently crappy. That's why you've never met a lawyer who's happy. It's a guaranteed soul destroyer. Don't be a lawyer. That daily regret, is that what you dreamed of as a kid? Or did you hope one day that you find a way to spend 4 years working on a pharmaceutical company's merger with another pharmaceutical company? Your only expertise is running up fees, speaking legalese like a dick. But it's not too late to avoid this fate, find any other job to pick. Sure, your parents might think you're a failure, but no one's ever said, first let's kill all the tailors. Don't be a lawyer. I'm serious, it really, really sucks. Don't be a lawyer. No one you work with looks like Ally McBeal. There are so many other professions that don't turn you into Jeff Sessions. Just say no to the lawyer employer. No, don't be a lawyer.
What about human rights law?
No money, no, no money.
Environmental law?
No money, even less money.
Immigration law?
No money, plus it's a bummer.
Okay, but what if one day you make it to the Supreme Court?
It'd be great to be on the Supreme Court, but you'll never be on the Supreme Court. There's truly no chance of that happening.
The preceding song in no way reflects the views of CBS and the CW Network.
Okay, remember, I said you got to do one thing that makes you laugh every day. I got three more minutes, and this is 1 minute and 55 seconds, and this really makes me laugh.
And they're off. Out of the gate, it's coronavirus, followed closely behind by Wuhan-style lockdown. On the outside, it's global pandemic, working hard against flatten the curve. Social distancing got off to a slow start, but he's now neck and neck with flatten the curve. On the inside, it's just a little flu, followed by trust the experts. As they pass the quarter pole, 18 months vaccine is working hard to get past Plaquenil. Dr. Fauci is three lengths back of the leaders. Stimulus plan is trying to squeeze by PPE as they enter the backstretch. But out on the outside, here comes economic shutdown. Open by Easter, gets bumped a little bit by Dr. Fauci. Flatten the curve and economic shutdown are battling it out as they head past the half-mile pole. Distance learning stumbled out of the gate, and it looks like he won't be able to get back into it. Not his day-to-day, folks. They are moving at a brisk pace and all clustered together except for my bank account, which is way back of the pack. He might be injured. They might have to pull him up. Toilet paper is nowhere to be seen. He's lost in the pack. As they head into the far turn, it's social distancing still in the lead, but daily briefing is lurking 1.5 lengths back. It's a tremendous race, folks. I've never seen anything like it. And now, cure worse than the disease is starting to make his move. As they enter the top of the stretch, cabin fever is charging hard, but social distancing is holding him off. Economic shutdown is still looking strong, and he's nose to nose with cure worse than the disease. And on the inside, here comes Dr. Fauci, and down the stretch they come. It's social distancing and economic shutdown now neck and neck. I don't believe it. Dr. Fauci is trying to keep pace, and with 1 furlong to go, it's economic shutdown, social distancing, and Dr. Fauci. And as they come to the wire, it's, oh my God, it's no one fucking knows by a head. Oh, an incredible race, folks. 11-7-12, trifecta pace 117.39.
Okay, that always makes me laugh. Okay, I'm going to end by saying I'm inviting you. Every Monday through AAJ, Deb got her email, I do 10-minute mindful meditation. And it will be my 8th or 9th one, I think, next time. Every Monday, it's 10 o'clock our time. And it takes about 15 or 20 minutes because I have a topic. Everybody's invited, try it out, pass it around because you never know what people are going through. and always. Where you can be anything, be kind. And nothing has touched me more than these pictures that have been taken in the last week. I was going to show some videos of police officers kneeling and hugging people because it's so kind. So thank you. Thank you for having me. I hope this was helpful to you.
Lisa, there's one more question we got. And before I ask that, can you hear me okay, Lisa?
Perfect.
Okay. If everyone in the chat function, we are planning some other, the DAYL is planning some other seminars coming up for law students. And Sherry can probably talk a little bit about that. If you have any suggestions on seminars you'd like to see, this one was fantastic. It'll be hard to match this one. I know one of the ones that's being discussed is having a couple federal judges come in to talk about how to become a federal law clerk, what the process is and what they look for. And I know people are interested in that. But if you have any other suggestions of topics you'd like us to cover in future DAYL seminars for the judicial interns, please feel free to put that in the chat. And Lisa, the chat is disabled, so I apologize. You can't make suggestions. Put suggestions in the Q&A. But the one good question we had here was, in these times of COVID and racial injustice, how do you compartmentalize horrible information we ingest on the news daily with meditating and clearing your mind? It seems hard to be mindful when the world around us is so unknown.
I mean, that's a great question, and that question proves everything about mindfulness, because if you don't have a way to train your brain to shut off, to calm down, to train it just to be present, then your mind is going to whirl with that. So yes, it's horrible and very touching what's going on. But remember, one of those suggestions was to write down, what do you really have control over and what do you not? And just being kind to people. Look at what these officers that have kneeled and held people that are upset. So there is a way that just being in the present moment can make all of us happier.
That's perfect. Does anybody else have any questions that they would like to ask Lisa? This is an amazing opportunity. Lisa, that was a fantastic presentation. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk to these folks. We have a great group of interns. I have actually, believe it or not, my largest class ever.
Wow.
A lot of them, we have more judicial interns, I think, this summer, partly because it's such a tough economic time for law students. So this was really motivational. I hope it was helpful to everyone here.
And the one thing I would say to everybody, I promise you, no matter how hard it seems or stressful, it will get back to normal. And you can just work on improving yourself, because there's so many things you can do. And thank you, Judge, for having me.
Thank you so much. Sherry, we do have another chat. It says, for getting started, do you recommend using an app? Would that be a good first step?
I think it'd be a great first step. My practice, I do 10 minutes without an app. And then sometimes I have, thoughts that I try to just let evaporate. But then I always do 10 minutes of an app called Calm, because I like her voice. And she always has a topic of the day. Today's topic was actually learning how to be tremendously focused. So, but yes, anything that will help you, anything that will get you started, it's just a great technique. Yes.
So Lisa, I'm going to change the subject for a moment, if you don't mind just staying on for a couple more minutes. One of the things that I saw you do a number of years ago that was really changed a lot of things for young lawyers is you were one of our first speakers at the DAYL Trial Skills Bootcamp. And we are having the boot camp again. One of our featured speakers is one of your mentees, Chris Hamilton. He always speaks very highly of you, and I know that you really helped change the trajectory of his career. And so I would urge all of you to sign up for the Trial Skills Boot Camp. Sherry, if you want to get back on, we've had the top lawyers in Dallas. Of course, the very first one had Lisa Blue. We've had amazing lawyers in We've had amazing lawyers this year. Lisa Blue, I'm sure you know Leon Carter and Laura Geisler are both speakers. And then Judge Maricela Moore is going to be our fourth speaker. It should be a fantastic presentation. It's on June 20th. Sherry, if you're there, can you want to get on and mention anything else about upcoming programming?
Yeah, we'll send an email. Lisa has put together this fantastic PowerPoint. She's generously offered to send it to everybody. So in with that email that we send out with the PowerPoint, I'll include some opportunities for upcoming events as well.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much, everyone. We really appreciate it. Lisa, again, thank you for being here and presenting to our law students. And hope you guys have a great rest of your week. Stay safe out there. And remember, I agree with Lisa. I was a judge when we went through the last economic downturn, and it gets better, and things get turned around. So in the long run, everything will get better. So just keep with it, and we hope you're safe out there. Oh, I had one more question. Let me see. Okay. They ask about, okay, this is a slightly different topic. I don't think what you're saying here is that we should ignore things like racial injustice. That's not kind of what you're saying. You're saying that the question is, should we always try to keep that at the forefront of our minds, but also try to deal with keeping ourselves sane as well. Is that right, Lisa?
If you're living in the present moment, you are aware of what's going on right now. But being mindful about it, it doesn't mean that you don't care about other people. Remember, if you don't take care of yourself, how can you take care of other people? If you don't, being present for your friends, for your spouse, for your boyfriend, girlfriend, being present is a gift that you give to other people.
All right. Thank you so much. And with this, we'll go ahead and conclude the program. Thank you, Lisa.
Thank you. Bye, everybody.